So I'll introduce you real quick. Sitting down with Bill Eakin. Is it Eakin or Eakin?
Yeah, it's Eakin.
Okay. I'd heard Eakin, and then I've said Eakin, but anyway, wanted to confirm. So hey, I'm happy to finally sit down with you. You know, we were talking a few months back, and just now got to get together. So
yeah.
I really appreciate you taking the time and reaching back out.
Well, thank you for having me, Brian.
Yeah, so we're actually going to do two parts. We're going to talk today about early Bill, and just kind of intro the audience, and I think we'll follow up on some more recent work that I'm also equally as excited to talk to you about. So.
Yeah, I'm excited about it too.
Yeah, so ironically, I didn't know until I started looking into your background that you have a serious background with philosophy.
Yeah.
You know, I'd seen you, my philosophy professor, Dr. Charles Bush, just passed away. Great professor. I had him for all of his stuff except for one class.
Yeah. Charlie Bush hired me when I first came here at Arkansas Tech.
Really?
And so, yeah, I worked part-time there for a long time. Worked part-time at U of O, University of the Ozarks. But Charlie and I, you know, worked together. And when I went on sabbatical, he came. I guess I can say this now that no one can bug him to do it. He came and taught a class for free.
Wow.
For me, you know, one of my classes up at the University of the Ozarks.
Wow.
Just because he's dang decent.
He one of the best people I've ever met.
Absolutely.
Honestly.
And a good thinker, too.
Yes. So. You know, one thing I recorded on a little handheld Tascam, all of his lectures.
Oh wow!
And I have them.
Oh
and,
wow!
But they're not organized. They're like just named numbers, like X0294, whatever the.
Sounds like a good all night broadcast someplace.
Yeah, yeah right. Did you know Professor David Krieger?
Yes.
Okay, so I had him.
Yeah,
he was
he's
an
great
equally
historian,
equally important. But he did something like that when UACCM was setting up. They started teaching Western Civ when they converted from just a technical college to actually offering gen ed courses.
Right.
And Krieger went up there and kind of got the thing up and rolling. You know, Thomas Flowers, he teaches there, but was an admin, like a vice chancellor or something.
Right.
And
right.
He was telling me all about this. I was like, wow.
Yeah. So the first thing I taught when I came to Arkansas Tech, they started the core humanities course called Arts and Ideas.
Oh, wow.
And so I got to teach that, and I had what it meant is I had to learn a heck of a lot really fast because I had a degree in philosophy, but not in music and not in art. And, you know, and so I learned art history and music and religion and poetry and literature, did all sorts of stuff in order to get ready for it. And it was probably the best learning experience I had. And I ended up teaching that at the University of the Ozarks, too, and figured, well, I spent 30 years teaching around here. That was the best education I could get.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I felt that way. You know, and two, I walked away with so many my notes, you know, because I'd essentially taken courses I'd taken, converted those notes and to my notes and expanded on it and research, and I just started a period of refinement for 4 years. So, but some courses I took Krieger for example, I'm working on right now, Enlightenment, French Revolution, Napoleon.
Yeah. So I ended up teaching courses like that are history courses, but also history of the fine arts. And because of that, I ended up taking students all over the world. So
You went to Egypt.
Yeah, we went to Egypt. We went to India. We went to Greece several times. We went to Italy several times. Went to France. Went to Germany. And some of those places I had already been, but some of them were, you know, just a way for me and my co-workers. I had a couple other professors, you know, go with us. It was our way to see the stuff we were doing live and in color. You know, so it's a weird thing to talk about architecture without seeing the buildings, but when you're showing it to people, to students, and some of the students from here had never been outside of Johnson County or Pope County, and so it was literally a chance for them to step off into the desert of Egypt.
What years were you doing these travel abroads, I thought?
Oh, well, it was actually before I was even hired full-time at the University of the Ozarks that I did a lot of travel abroad stuff. So I think that was 1998.
Okay, wow.
And really, my full-time, I was teaching pretty full-time. My yes. per capita was really high, so I've seen a lot of students. And so finally, I think they decided they needed to hire me. And so what I did was I finished up my PhD. So mm-hmm. I worked full-time at U of O. I went back and forth up to Fayetteville to finish a PhD I had started at UC Davis, California. And then I had three kids, and I was a single dad. So a single dad teaching all of that, and then going driving up and down the road, you know. And it wasn't like I-49; it was like Highway 71 or the Pig mm-hmm. Trail.
Oh man, that makes crazy. My wife Cora sick. Yeah, sometimes you know. Last time we went a different way to get to. We went to Eureka Springs just a few uh-huh. weeks ago. Mm-hmm. That I guess we just went up 7, right?
Yeah,
and cut over and. I hadn't gone that way to get there, but the last couple of times we took the Pig Trail, it was rough.
It's beautiful, though.
It is.
And I love it. And I love it even in the ice and snow and fog. Fog especially, because it seems like it's one of the roads. The 71 was a road where big trucks would have jackknifed. Mm-hmm. And so suddenly you're up in the middle of the mountains and you're stuck. And so, you know, it makes a long commute, but wow, it was great. It was an adventure.
Yeah, wow. So a huge fascination with Egypt. I have not been. Professor Krieger for a seminar in ancient Egypt, mm-hmm. which mm-hmm. was very influential on me. And that is one of the areas, like, I've already kind of ready to go on doing something with that podcast-wise. Like, I have a lot of stuff put together with that, but I really enjoyed that. What are some of the places you went to in Egypt that stood out?
Well, you know, of course, we went to Giza, mm-hmm. and so that involved things like going inside the Great Pyramid.
Did you climb it?
No, I don't think we were. I think we could climb part of it, so they were kind of being careful about what they
were.
Yeah. But as I recollect, we went inside it. Which is pretty amazing.
I think you have to pay a guard $20 to climb it. That's what I've heard.
That might have been the flaw.
Might not even be a thing on the other side of the Arab Spring.
Yeah.
But,
It changed. This was right at the beginning of the Arab Spring. So it was like it was over by the time we had gone. Yeah. So, or it had kind of kicked in at least.
Yeah, that did change quite a bit with antiquities and
But we went to Abu Simbel. We went up and down the Nile. You know, I'm fascinated with the deities.
Yes.
And so we went to the Temple of Isis on the island of Philae.
Yes.
Oh man, it's so moving and so emotional, and so incredibly powerful. And I guess that's so in my literature, in my writing, and in my philosophy, I'm always interested in that sense of, like, being awestruck. And boy, what better place to be awestruck than Egypt?
Yes. And it's interesting with some of the sources we have, like, we mm-hmm. have all of this Egyptian mythology mm-hmm. and magic, uh-huh. spells, incantations, mm-hmm. The religion,
mm-hmm.
but they didn't leave a whole lot of, like the Greeks, philosophical papyri for us to be, you know, oh, okay.
There's a lot of interesting philosophy, though, there.
But there is. Yeah. And you can glean that from those other sources. But, you know, one of this Egyptologist I really admired, Dr. Bob Breyer,
uh-huh.
he talks about how Plato said, I believe, that this was Plato, that, you know, the truest philosophy you don't write down.
No, absolutely. Well, that's Socrates.
Okay.
Or
okay.
Socrates
in
is quoted
Plato's
by
dialogue.
Plato.
Okay.
Yeah. So Socrates didn't write anything down as far as we know.
Had no students.
And so it left a perplexity of kinds of questions like, did Socrates, so Socrates would ask, would show people they didn't know what they were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I'm doing you a favor showing you how ignorant you are, because by the way, that means you can now go out and learn. And all this time you weren't learning. And so he says this in front of 501 people who are looking at putting him to death, which they do, of course.
Yes.
And so they're putting him to death. And he says, and they say, well, look, all you got to do is change what you're doing. Stop asking so many dang questions. And he says, well, I couldn't do that. What I'm doing is asking questions because that's the right thing to do. And what it does is it shows all you 501 citizens how idiotic and stupid you are. And I'm doing you a favor because now you can go learn.
And you're being impious and corrupting the young.
Well, and you know what? I think we'd all put him to death for that. You're calling me ignorant and thanks. So I think that's wonderful. And that's what Aristotle says, philosophy begins with wonder. And he means partly curiosity, but it's a lot mm-hmm. more than that, too. I think it's also a sense of being awestruck. And Plato in the Timaeus says, you know, the reason we were formed with eyes was so that we could look up and see the stars. And I think that's brilliant. I just think that's just really true. And he meant also so that we could do the math of the stars and, you know, get sort of, you know, moved into thinking about how the structure of the universe is. But I think it's also just being awestruck. I mean, that's so I think philosophy and literature and some of the best things that I try to do are about getting awestruck.
Yeah, certainly.
And if I'm not awestruck by something, I wonder why I did it. You know?
Yeah. You know.
And even the Bible, by the way. You know, there's a psalm, stand in awe and sin not. But stand in awe is the first part. And I think, it got you.
You know, with the psalms, there are a lot of parallels mm-hmm. with Egyptian literature.
Mm-hmm.
I forget which psalm it is, but I have it in my notes, the hymn of Aten. Do you need a little extra slack there?
No, I'm good.
Okay, good. But the hymn to Aten. Akhenaten was this heretic pharaoh, monotheistic sort of.
Right.
People get into a debate on that because he was having the people worship him, and then he was worshiping this other god for them.
Right.
So people have debated if it was a true monotheistic religion. I've seen it as such. That's what everybody remarks on that pharaoh.
Yeah.
But 18th dynasty, right there at the end. But it's interesting. That's one case. There's another one called sometimes it's a stone found in a farmer's field, the philosophy of a Memphite priest.
Yeah.
And there's some parallels with the creation story.
Right.
Enuma Elish, found in Mesopotamia. There's parallels with the creation story with that. Dr. Bush used to always say there are over 200 creation myths, stories.
Right.
And two-thirds of them contain a flood.
Yeah. Well, and of course, the primary model for the Genesis story comes out of the Epic of Gilgamesh, out of Sumer.
Yeah, and the parallels there, yeah.
The parallels
huge.
Are more than parallels. They're amazingly similar.
The leaf with the bird.
With the exception of the bird and a few other things, that some of the order is reversed.
Mm-hmm.
So what gets sent out from the boat is at different times,
mm-hmm.
you know, differs from the biblical account. But I'm not sure. There's lots of ideas about where the biblical and other parallels come from and why they're there. And some people argue, well, that proves that it was a history. Well, no, it doesn't really. What it does is it proves that there's shared stories that from ancient Sumer and Egypt. Plato himself says, everything I learned in Egypt.
That's what really got us going down this.
Yeah.
And too, that I was thinking that earlier is the not writing the philosophy down and how much of the Greek influence came from the Egyptians with building in stone with philosophy, that's going and studying with the priest.
Well, Socrates, you know, is is famous for saying, you know what you don't know and know that you don't know what you don't know. And if that's true, then that's why we need to know how stupid we are about so much and mm-hmm. how little we know and how small, you know, the spectrum of knowledge is. And when we write it down, Socrates thought, you've made it concrete and it's no longer living. And because it's no longer living,
yes.
you know, you don't have that sense of awe, that sense of awakening, this sense of surprise.
Mm-hmm.
Plato says, what I want to do is he has Socrates say in his literature, I want to drill into your head until you realize you don't know what you're talking about. And then there's a moment where you're stung by this. There's a fish that stings you and paralyzes you for just a moment. And that's what I want you to do. I want you to be paralyzed for just a moment so you can shut up and listen.
Mm-hmm, just appreciate.
And that's, I think that's really powerful because it really means, you know, once you're really stunned, you're totally disoriented, you're totally cut aloof, you're cut off from all the things you believe and want and know and thought you know, and then suddenly you really can start hearing and seeing differently.
Mm-hmm.
And man, I believe in that. So yeah. I guess that's why I got into philosophy in part, was because it, you know, it teaches you to see, as does religion, the best of religion, it teaches you to see differently.
Yeah.
And so does traveling. So does traveling to Egypt and Greece.
Certainly.
You know, you see the world differently.
Certainly.
And yeah.
Yeah. So question, just because I have you as a mind in the studio, I'm really don't know what I think about this. I want to ask more philosophers what they think about it. But Dr. Bush would bring this up, that there is perhaps some debate that maybe Socrates was just a character in Plato's dialogues, even though there is another reference of Socrates by a different...
Xenophon.
Yes.
There are several others. And in fact, there are other accounts of his trial. But the way they present him in his trial is different. So Xenophon sees him as more in political terms and less in metaphysical, philosophical, spiritual terms like Plato does. So Plato has him, it's obvious he's a character, and there's at least part of Plato's dialogues where he's putting Plato's thoughts into Socrates. And for a while it was important for philosophers in the mid-century, last century, it was important for them to figure out when's Plato's being Plato and when's Plato's Socrates really presented as Socrates. And so they developed a whole chain of the historical development of his dialogues where they argued at the beginning, he's just asking questions and he leaves the questions open. And those are the quote-unquote Socratic dialogues.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's dialogues where they start teaching about things, or Socrates starts teaching about things that are like the good and the beautiful and the just. And he starts giving answers. And these guys back in the mid-century said things like, well, that must be the real Plato coming through. Or as he learns, he develops it and gives his answers. So it's most people think Socrates was around, but he could very well have been. The way he's presented is certainly literary and certainly an invention.
Yeah, you know, and this is you take a figure in history like Romulus, the mythical first king and founder of Rome.
Yeah,
you know, which I love going into that Roman kingdom period.
Yeah,
but you know, you take somebody like him. Most scholars agree he's an archetypal figure,
right?
You know, perhaps based off of a few early people that we just don't know enough about, and later people telling this story. But I've wondered if there isn't some sort of an, you know, like you mentioned, how he's viewed political terms, philosophical terms.
Maybe
there is some archetypal possibility.
If you go back that far, so one of the options for, you know, imagining that there's a reason why everybody has similar myths about the flood or myths about creation. One of the arguments is we learned it from each other culturally, or it was diffused. Another argument is there's just structures in our mind that when we see things, we think of them in a particular way, and that we share an unconscious mind, at least some people think, or a kind of set of archetypes that we refer to again and again, and you end up seeing it in art and in literature. And for me, that's where that sense of awe gets really drawn mm-hmm. out. So like I'm awed when I read, well, the Genesis account of Noah, which is kind of cool, interesting. I don't approach it as history per se, but I see it as an awesome thing.
Mm-hmm.
But then when I read the Epic of Gilgamesh, you know, with Utnapishtim, who is the Noah character, literally, you know, literally the Noah character, I start getting awed by that too. And then mm-hmm. when you see a whole bunch of it, you realize there's something these kinds of myths or the writings or the stories or the, you know, good old, you know, paintings from antiquity, those things kind of reach into you and grab you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I think the best literature comes from too. And so that's what I'm doing in a lot of my writing, going yeah. kind of digging in, not intentionally to the archetype, but when you hit one, you say, wow, whether there is an archetype or not in all of us, there's something that makes, you know, our strings vibrate.
Yeah, and I mentioned this as maybe before we started recording, but, you know, this fascinating concept of the muse,
mm-hmm.
right? Mm-hmm. I go into when I talk about the library at Alexandria and then the museum
mm-hmm.
that was also built. It was the muse, the place of the muses, the place yeah. of the nine muses. So yeah. It's interesting that that's the museum. I try and just make that
connection. It's also interesting that we can be amusing, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, the muse is all over the place. And so I think that when a poet or a lyric, someone who writes fiction from a lyric perspective, which is what mm-hmm. I'm really interested in, really sings, is when they stop speaking themselves. And so they're quiet, like Socrates, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they just let it out. And letting it out, you get in touch with, you know, literally the strings that are vibrating in you. And that's something like the muse. So I see myself, and I spend a lot of time talking about it in my fiction. A lot, you know, I'm amused and mused by the muse. I'm drawn to it, and you see it in other people, but they're kind of just living toward what that muse is too.
Mm-hmm.
So Dante had his muse, and he followed her and wrote about her and, you know, put her in the highest heavens, but it was really something that no human person could ever be. It's just some kind of, well, I put it in terms of wonder and awe.
Yes.
It's just knocked flat. So when I write I write short stories mostly because
mm-hmm.
I got really busy when I first moved here and was teaching and going and, you know, all the stuff I was telling you, I didn't have time to write a novel. So I wrote a whole bunch of short stories,
mm-hmm.
literally for 30 years. And all these stories work only when I stop being there and I just let it go. And I let it go and the muse just speaks and sings. And I put it in terms of frogs in the swamp singing, because I can hear that same thing there.
Mm-hmm.
And I hear it in the stars. And, you know, the stars were supposed to, by the Greeks, supposed to have emitted a sound. So there's the music of the spheres. The music of the sphere, the music
yes, yes.
of the spheres. There it is. There's the muse again. It's all in everything. And people like William Wordsworth in the 19th century and some of those poets spoke a lot about that. There's something in the setting sun or something in the rising of clouds that just makes you full of wonder.
Yeah.
My dad was in the Air Force, and so we traveled around quite a lot. But he was a weatherman. And so what he did when we were in the Pacific and we were over Japan and Okinawa and Guam and places like that, he'd get in a typhoon reconnaissance airplane, and they'd fly into a typhoon, a hurricane, and be in the eye and travel around the Pacific doing barometric pressure readings. And as he did that, he said the most beautiful things on earth that he ever saw were sunsets from the middle of an eye, literally the eye of a hurricane. And, you know, that I just, that made such a dent in me.
And that, well, that wouldn't even have been possible in the ancient world.
No, absolutely not, because if the hurricane comes, you go hide.
Yeah, wow.
That Although in Okinawa and places like that, the farmers would go out and fish, you know, right in the middle of a typhoon. They died doing it, but they caught really good fish that way, too.
Yeah, I bet. Wow.
Yeah, so, but anyway, that sense of awesomeness in the sky is really, for me, the muse talking. And when you write poetry about it, like William Wordsworth did, you know, the muse sings, and it's successful poetry. If it doesn't sing, well, you got in the way too much of it.
Yeah.
Stop being in the way.
Did you go to Hatshepsut's temple? Jezu is one word for it. The other is Holy of Holy Places, I think, is the translation of Jezu, but I can't remember. I'm blanking
The answer is yes.
Yeah, okay.
And it was very impressive.
Wasn't it Sinemut? If you went to his tomb, that has the constellations on the ceiling.
Well, they all do.
Okay, yes.
So, and in fact, that carries over into Greek and Russian Orthodox churches, too. And that carries over into French cathedrals. Mm-hmm. So if you go to Saint-Chapelle in Paris, the side aisles all have star. They're fleur-de-lis often because they're French, right?
Yes.
But they have blue sky with yellow fleur-de-lis decorating the vaults.
Mm-hmm.
And we went inside King Tut's tomb. So wow. It's closed, but they were open when we were there. And so we went inside, and it was literally like you walked into this room with the heavens inside this, like in a cave. And it's like, wow, heaven is here. And then it's populated with gods and goddesses and with people living in the hieroglyphics. And some amazing, amazing things that friends of mine would be glad to expound upon, because we all saw things that seemed like they were very personal. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't just a historical moment. It was a lake full of snakes, for example. And serpents, of course, are symbolic of wisdom as well as death.
This artist, I have several of his pieces in here. There's snakes in all of his work.
Serpents are really, really important because, A, they become tempters for us for a long time in the Islamic and Christian traditions, but that's in part a response to the early religions and early ways of thinking that said, no, snakes are eternal. They represent eternity, and they're divine. And so, you know, they eat, if it's eats
snake
its
eating
tail,
itself, yeah.
You know, or it's a healing thing. So you see it in the good
medicine, yes.
And so that really figures strongly with the Greeks, but it was also in the Egyptian temple or in the Egyptian tomb.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw other weird things that so I grew up loving science fiction. So a lot of my writing and a lot of the reason I went into philosophy was because the best of science fiction asks good questions. And so, as an example, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, right? It turned into a bad movie with Donald Sutherland. A really good movie in 1954 with, I forget who was in it, but this woman has gone home. She finds out that her aunt thinks her husband, her Uncle Ira, isn't Uncle Ira. And so she goes, the woman meets a doctor friend of hers and says, come see Uncle Ira. I want you to tell me if he's any different than what you knew about Uncle Ira. And he goes to see Uncle Ira. Uncle Ira is mowing the lawn. And And this guy talks to him for a little while, and he says there was nothing different about Uncle Ira. His voice was the same. The way he greeted me was the same. His hair was the same. Every single hair follicle was the same. Everything was identical. But there was something wrong with Uncle Ira. And, of course, what happened with Uncle Ira is these plants invaded the earth, and they're slowly, they take over and replace you. And so they replace you, and there's something different. But no one can say, what's the difference? Because there's no real difference. And so that's a philosophical question. What makes an identity, a person identical one minute to the next? Or if he undergoes a change? Or if I lost all my memory, would I still be me? Or is my grandmother in the nursing home, is she still her? You know, we say, oh, she's not herself. Well, wait, what's the difference? Or like, I came in here 10 minutes ago, and since then, I'm sure I've lost some skin.
For sure. Gym is especially
bad. Yeah, there's skin all over the place. Yeah.
No. We did a deep dusting over this past, which we did. We dust, but like, that got really everything.
But it's perpetual, and every second is different. So why am I identical to the person who started this sentence? That's a good question. So for me, the philosophical question and the science fiction question feed into one another, feed into each other. Mm-hmm. And so I write about that. So my fiction is really philosophical in terms of, you know, asking some questions that you can't do except you have them acted out somehow. How do you get there? So the question of identity is really interesting. There's a guy named Parfit back in the 1990s who was arguing that if I got into a Star Trek transporter, and I got transported from spot A to spot B on the moon or Mars, I'd have to be dismantled here. And if that's true, does that mean I'm somehow transported over here, or am I just digitally copied and then transported over here? And if so, if I'm just a digital copy, and this back here was destroyed, that means they killed me and then resurrected me. But wait, in order to be resurrected, don't I have to be the same guy? And if all I am is the data transferred over here, am I the same guy? What makes me the same guy? Is it memories? Is it a sense of continuity? John Locke thought it was I have a sense of personal continuity with that. Well, what happens, and so Parfit asks, and other people do too, and I do in some of my science fiction, what happens if you get into a teletransporter? So I've got a story. It's not a Redgunk story, but it's one that was published. And unfortunately, the only place I have it in existence now is in German. So it's a German story. This is post-apocalyptic, and there's a bunch of people wandering the grounds, you know, so it's dangerous to go outside walking. He's an 80-year-old man, and he used to walk from one castle to another to be with his family, and then back again on a footpath, so it's called the footpath. His kids say, you know, Dad, no one's walking from one place to another anymore. We have to teletransport. It's the only way to do it. And he says, well, I can't do it. I'm not going to do it. What if something happens? And they say, Dad, what could possibly happen? And he says, look, I have a memory of my wife, Alice, and we were in Paris. And if something happened to me, I could lose that. And I don't want to lose that. And so they finally talk him into going. Dad, it's simple. Everybody's doing it now. We're just teletransporting from one place to another. No big whoop. And so he finally agrees to do it. And just as he arrives in his second place of business, an alarm goes off, of course. And he goes, oh. And sure enough, he gets down and he meets his kids over here in the second place. And they say, Dad, don't panic. It's not that big a deal, but you got replicated. So the digital information that we sent over here got reproduced in another person. And so there's now two of you. And so he thinks, okay, now wait a minute. Which of, do we need to?
No, you're good. You're good. I was just looking at my little input meters over here at the bottom. Okay. We're totally good.
He's worried now. Whose memory of Alice in Paris is that? If we both have it, if we both have we're identical in every way. How do I know I'm the original, or there is no original? Who owns these memories? And if we both do, who was married to Alice? And so, the final outcome of the story is he realizes, in order to be the one unique guy who is this individual, he has to kill his duplicate. And so he kills him, and he kills him in a kind of gruesome way. And he's sitting there thinking, now I'm me. Except then he realizes, wait, if I'm me, I would not have killed that guy. So in other words, he also has undergone a transformation, not for the better, and a sense of loss because of a loss of identity, because he's no longer himself. Hmm. So that's a philosophical question.
Yeah.
And a literary question, and I put it in a bunch of stories because I think it's just really fascinating. And it's just fascinating because, you know, how do you know you're the who walked in this morning? You know, if you had a big argument with somebody, did that change you enough to make you no longer you?
Yeah. What causes significant change in people? Things like, I was thinking this, a podcaster, historian guy, I'm friends with him on Facebook, just follow him, and he was talking about how 10 years ago his wife passed away. And that he was not the same for 10 years. It was a period of 10 years where he was not the same. He said things like there was a dark cloud following him and just nothing was the same. And then he goes, but things had not been that way for 1 year. And he's like, you know, what causes that change from now? He's like, is this going to be life as I know it moving forward? Like life was, you know, and did this impact me and change me? And that's what grief is, changed me for this time, but now I'm a newer version of.
So I think the thing that I've thought in relationship to Buddhism, having studied it since I was in eighth grade must have been a big year for me. Buddhism teaches that all things change and all things pass. Buddha's final words were, you know, all things pass, thrive on, strive on. And that meant, and he said at one point, that also meant for the teachings of Buddhism. So the Dharma also changes. If you're looking for the eternal thing that's in you, you're never going to find it, because you're looking for this kind of concrete block of stuff. And we think of ourselves that way. I think of this concrete block called Bill Eakin that, by the way, I can reach over and grab pleasure, you know, and because of that, I'm happy. I've grabbed it for me. But then what I've done is I've changed me in relationship. What I am is partly here looking at you, partly here talking into a microphone, partly here being surrounded by your studio and by the outside world and by what's going on in the news. That all, if you took away all of that and took away my sensations, my senses, what I'm smelling now, what I'm seeing now, what I'm feeling on my skin, and I looked for the I that stays there and will stay there in 10 minutes and will stay there and go to heaven when I die, maybe it's not like that at all. Maybe what I am is the interconnectedness of the moment. And because of that, beautiful things can happen. If I see myself being interconnected to everything in this moment, then if something horrible happens to a little kid outside in a parking lot, it's happened to me. because I'm built up out of that. I'm not a concrete block. I'm like a web of all these wonderful interconnectednesses. And that's what human beings are like. And so they say, instead of Atman, the self, we're not looking for Atman, we're looking for Anatman, the no-self. And that's where we are. And if we're a concrete block, we feel like we have to grab onto something, and then we got to keep it. And the bad thing about getting something that's like, I really want a Ferrari, so you go get a Ferrari, and you spend all this time hoping you can get your Ferrari, you know, and you sweat, yes, and your blood, and you work really hard, and you change your family, and you do everything, working, just trying to get to that Ferrari. And finally you get it. So this concrete block, you think, has caught the Ferrari. But then you start thinking, well, but now I got to take care of it. And now I hope somebody doesn't steal it. And oh my gosh, what if somebody scratches it in the parking lot? And suddenly, all the stuff that hasn't happened, that maybe won't happen, is still hurting you.
Yes.
It's hurting your state of mind. When in fact, all this time you've trying to grab hold of something concrete so that you, the concrete self, can hold it. But in fact, when you look at a Ferrari, it falls apart. All things must pass. All things. And if the all things must pass, if we saw that, we'd be less likely to see that as, you know, all-consumingly important. And if we saw that that happens to us, we'd know it about us too. That, to me, is powerful, to realize that what a person is isn't something that can hang on to anything. And in fact, we want to do that with people. We really want to do it with people. We don't want to do it with our grandmother when she dies. We say, oh man, you know, I wish she was here. I wish I could hold on to her. And we do. We can't help that. But wishing it so totally as if it could be that way takes over a part of the way we think and the way we see clearly. And what if we could just see clearly that, wow, I feel bad about my mom, my grandmother dying. And wow, I do miss her, but I'm separate in some ways from that, because what I am is all of those emotions, but underneath that emotion isn't this substance that has to hold it all together. I don't need that. I have wonderful life, and the life changes and grows and moves and hurts and is joyful, all of it, and I can embrace all of that. And I think that's what Buddhism teaches me. Friedrich Nietzsche does too. It says, you know, I'm a yes sayer. I want to say yes to life, to amor fati, love fate, no matter how bad it is, no matter what's going on. You can love this moment, in fact. Because, by the way, it's all you got.
Yeah, you know, one thing I tell people that... you know, I grew up in a Christian church, mm-hmm. went 19 years. But, you know, then I learned a lot about Judaism when I got out, just in my historical studies. Mm-hmm. And just, too, seeing that there's really not a whole lot of emphasis on an afterlife, really any, in Judaism, that's an interesting thought. And yeah. It's kind of like reminded me what you just said. It's like this is what we have. Yeah. In fact, this may be all we have.
Yeah.
And in trying to, I mean, I think about that often myself, in relation of how to live, you know, it's maybe this is it. And
well, even if it wasn't, even if it's Nietzsche's wrong, it's not, this is the only, you know, it's just, there's no afterlife. Even if there is an afterlife, what kind of person are we going to be in the afterlife? Are we going to be somebody who tries to grab hold of things and hold on to them? Or can we be somebody who lets things flow through us and be in the moment, mm-hmm. and really fully see what the moment is like and really fully be thankful for it? And if we're thankful for every moment, then I guess if I'm going to go to heaven, I want to be in heaven being thankful for the moment. Maybe we could do that anywhere. And maybe we are supposed to do that now. Maybe there's no supposed to. Maybe, why not? It's the best thing. Just to feel thankful for each and every moment and to feel each and every moment for its value.
You know, one thing that I've been putting together a big piece on the philosophs, right? So, and I just recently listened to a great courses on Voltaire. I want to give the credit to the author. It's really, I actually listened to it twice in a row.
Uh-huh.
It was only, you know, those great courses are usually 30-minute lectures.
Right.
And it was only 12 lectures. So I went through it pretty quick. But Voltaire and the Triumph and the Enlightenment by Alan Charles Kors, K-O-R-S. But he, in the chapters of this, he goes into Voltaire and God, Voltaire and organized religion, Voltaire and the... It goes into a discussion about his trying to reconcile the problem of evil.
Right.
You know, and really fascinating discussion there by this presenter. But that is an interesting thing also that, you know, you think about that just kind of in my mind coming up, it's like if this is the best of all possible worlds type, you know, how is...
Yeah.
Why are we grieving for our loved ones? And are these things that we can't reconcile? Like, for example, and it's really made me feel, but Sunday morning I was in here working, and I got a text message from one of the students here that this jiu-jitsu 8-time world champion black belt was murdered in Brazil. I mean, I stood next to this guy and ate some acai at Worlds. Like, I've been around him. I never talked to him, but... He just was out, and somebody just shot him. And it just, you know, it was just a major loss of that community of which I'm a part of. And watched his footage and showed it some 2 weeks ago to one of my students. I was like, watch what he's doing here, you know. And but just, you know, you think about that, and it was just like, it wasn't so much a random act. Randomness is what really makes me get into thinking about this. It wasn't so much a random act of violence, but just one of those things that happens. And when you are into training martial arts for something like self-defense, and he's a sport guy, but still, then something like that happens.
Yeah, so the problem of evil is has always been an interesting one to me because, of course, everybody faces it. And Job in the Bible faces it. Job's friends in the Bible come along and say, look, you must have done something wrong to have all this bad stuff happen to you. And the truth of the Job text is, no, he didn't do anything wrong. He's presented as a perfect man, Job is. And so why did he have these bad things happen? Why do bad things happen to good people? There's a book by Rabbi Kushner who says, you know, I had a son who... had progeria, I think is what it's called. Progeria is a rapid aging thing, so that by the time he was 13, he was roughly the equivalent of a body of a 65, 70-year-old, and he died. And I shook my fist at God, and I said, why? And the people who think the problem of evil is one that asks against God, all good God who is all perfect and who would do whatever he could, and of course he could have avoided that, raise that as an objection to God. But Rabbi Kushner says, you know what, it didn't ask me does God exist, it asked me what's my relationship with this deity, and can I shake my fist at him, and can I curse God? And sure enough, I mean, it's a relationship. So he gives a different kind of answer for that. But I'm very struck by, well, Friedrich Nietzsche. My understanding of Nietzsche is he argues that in the height of tragedy, the greatest tragedy is when we're invited to really embrace and say yes to life. because at that moment, we have the worst thing that could possibly have happened, the worst thing. And my emotions are still there. They're not going to go away. But what I can do is understand them in the context of just being me and being thankful for life itself. And so he tries this hypothesis. Some people think it's just a thought experiment. Other people, like Martin Heidegger, think it's really what he thinks. That it, given an infinite, the claim is given an infinite amount of time and a finite amount of matter, the stuff in the universe is just atoms for the claim. And over an infinite amount of times, those atoms will configure in a particular way. This way. Oh, by the way, where we're sitting here. And then another infinity of time down along the way, we'll get the same exact configuration. Because given an infinite amount of time, possible infinite combinations, it'll recur. This moment actually will recur. And so the claim is, if you have an eternal recurrence, something that recurs again and again and again and again, even if it's totally random, it's not totally random, because at the far end of infinity, we got it again, then every moment eternally recurs. And if that's accurate, he argues, or he tries us out, imagine a demon coming up to you and saying, hey, Brian, do you choose this moment or not? Do you run away in horror because you're not living it the way you want to? You're not really here. Or do you embrace it and say, yeah, I choose them all, every one of them, even the ones that hurt? And to me, that's life affirmation. If you could do that all the way to heaven, and if there is a heaven or not, it doesn't matter, because what you've got, well, it does matter. But where you are is where you are. And you can either affirm it or try to get away from it. But getting away from it, where are you going to go? Being negative and resenting it is where it really starts to weigh you down. He calls it the spirit of gravity. We get weighed down by resentment and by jealousy and anger and upsetness. We can't help the emotions, but we can see it differently. And maybe we can see it as a gift. And I guess I believe that.
Yeah. You know, another thing that just popped up in our discussions here, and kind of back on the topic before this one, but consciousness, you know, is it, you know, maybe being streamed from elsewhere, in a sense, right? Like where, you know, you were talking about your body. Dr. Bush used to always say, is this just a bloody hunk of meat? You know, the mind body problem, right? But, but then too, within like our body versus consciousness, and just what you and I have going on right now, we're talking about these, is Dr. Bush would also say, things are getting kind of heady in here. He would say that all the time, but they really are,
right,
you know, these are, very interesting questions. And that what I love about philosophy is it is a thought exercise. It's the ultimate thought exercise for me.
Yeah.
And it crosses over into everything. And, you know, been thinking about Carl Jung and
mm-hmm.
archetypes earlier,
mm-hmm.
Nietzsche.
Mm-hmm.
Also, everyone I know in psychology is super into Nietzsche.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, but this is, you know, the origin of our thoughts. Like we were talking about muses earlier,
mm-hmm.
but
mm-hmm.
in that being potentially, is it possible separate from our body, and our body dies, our consciousness, and maybe from its point of origin is still exists, maybe it doesn't, and that's really, I guess, the ultimate debate on the afterlife.
Yeah, and I guess I'm not sure a lot of that matters. So I think one of the real questions is, how much does it matter? And so I know people who think that we're being our consciousness is being streamed in from the Pleiades, an insect population there. And no, I mean, they really think it. I've got like 6 or 7 books on that topic.
Wow.
6 or 7 different people writing about. So those are people you want to put on your show.
Yes.
Because they're fascinating. And if you go on TikTok, you'll see them. Some of those guys are saying, look, I heard from, you know, the praying mantis out in the Pleiades. And that's not to make fun of it. That's really what they think. And so, but I just wonder, you know, the hardcore philosopher type of the 20th century would say, does that make a difference to your life?
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. Maybe it gives you a different perspective on things. That's interesting. I guess it's just interesting. But with Voltaire, I guess, so the thing about Candide by Voltaire is that at the end of the book and at the end of his life, he said, I'm just going to go tend my garden. And, you know, he is out there solving all the problem of evil and, you know, all these other things and trying to deal with, you know, the really big questions. And the Buddha says this too. The Buddha says, look, suppose you come to me and you say, I'm suffering. It's like an arrow in my gut. Well, I could then respond to you like a philosopher and say, well, the velocity of your arrow was probably this, and it was following the aerodynamic principle of, you know. And so we could do an analysis of why there's an arrow in your gut. Or we could just pull the arrow out. And if pull the arrow out means maybe we could stop thinking and just start being. And in that moment when we're really being, maybe that's what all the thinking was about. How do we get to just being here? And you see it in the martial arts. Big part of the martial arts to just be fully present.
For sure. You know, I tell this to my students, and I remark on it in my training over the last 16 years, but, you know, do you take something like boxing or kickboxing, mm-hmm. or just MMA if there's a striking component, right?
Mm-hmm.
Even karate, point sparring, any of that. There is this idea that, okay, I'm going to do this combination, jab, cross hook. You know, and it people think, okay, yeah, all right, I'm going to do jab, cross hook. And they do it, and it doesn't work. And they're like, well, why didn't it work? And there is just something to kind of forcing it. You know, there is a sort of a no mind aspect,
mm-hmm.
to you do the training so when the moment arises, you don't have to think about jab, cross hook.
Right.
And that thinking about it takes perhaps that 1 millisecond that it would have worked away.
And it strips it away.
Yes, so it is just that I think the highest form, if you look at some of the greatest ever,
mm-hmm.
they are in sort of a flow state with that. And they are not, the work has been done, so they don't have to do the thought. They're not appropriating mental energy.
So I believe that flow state makes what little, so my fiction, if I can be in a flow state with the writing, then I feel like I've gotten there.
Mm-hmm.
And if I can think in a flow state, we can think about philosophy but get so wrapped up in the minutiae that we fail to see how it can be life-forming and life-transforming. And I think that's where, well, Nietzsche's a good example of someone who was sort of in a flow state, but he carries it up to a real high level. And you can flow state through thinking, so you can have no mind in mind, if that makes sense.
It does. I've been using this kind of a interesting metaphor. So is a grown adult 30 something year old man. I've started mm-hmm. skateboarding. I got my two skateboards up here.
Yeah.
And I'm a member of that masterclass website.
Uh-huh.
And Tony Hawk, he has a skateboarding masterclass.
Yeah,
welcome to
cool.
2022.
Yeah, man.
Right? Like, so I've watched several, I haven't seen the whole thing. I watched several, the first several parts several times.
Uh-huh. You know.
But, you know, I'm looking at him doing basics, getting on and off the board.
Yeah.
Just kicking and making the board go.
Yeah.
And then putting his foot from kicking back onto the board. And then you turn your other foot as you do that.
Right.
And I can see that he does not think about that.
Yeah.
But I do.
Yeah.
I do.
And it
so
keeps
much
you from doing it.
I am able to achieve it, but it is just so. I'm skating with two or three friends right now, and I see them turning their feet, and they don't think about it either.
Right.
And I'm like trying to achieve this perfect way to stand on the board. And it really, the only time it's perfect is when it's not actually perfect,
yeah,
and I'm just on the board.
So
that's when I'm riding around the best.
So I lived in San Francisco for a while when I got one of my master's degrees in philosophy, and before I came back to this area, and played in a band. So we had a band with top 40 band kind of thing in San Francisco, and I was a lead singer.
Wow.
But I also occasionally played rhythm guitar.
Okay.
But I'm a horrible guitarist, not because I can't play pretty good rhythm. I can do that. But because I don't know how to stop thinking. But if you go watch Carlos Santana play, he's not thinking anything. He's mm-hmm. feeling it, and he's one with it, and it's a flow state. He's just there. And
yeah,
the best guitarists know exactly where the notes are, what to do, but they make them sing. And the only way you can make them sing is to get the muse in, or the flow state in, or just to be fully here and affirm it. I mean, it's all the same. It's like being here now.
Have you ever heard of a guy named Colonel Bruce Hampton? He passed away at the age of 70 playing at his birthday party, actually.
Mm.
But he's been like was this mentor to all of these bands I really appreciate. Widespread Panic is like my wife and I's favorite
uh-huh.
band.
Yeah,
but
I saw.
He was in a band with the now guitar player of Widespread Panic
mm-hmm.
called the Aquarium Rescue Unit.
Okay.
And the guy that now plays with the current lineup of, you know, Bob Weir still in the, you know, from the Grateful
mm-hmm.
Dead, still
mm-hmm.
plays.
Mm-hmm.
Otil Burbidge plays bass with that group,
uh-huh.
Dead and Company. Well, he was in that band. But this Colonel Bruce mm-hmm. Hampton, he's a mentor for all these people. Even this younger guy's in his early 20s named Taz. He was playing too, and he was 13 at the time or something when
yeah.
Colonel Bruce passed away.
Yeah.
But passed away doing what he loved.
Yeah, do it.
John Popper from, what is that band? Blues Traveler was playing a harmonica solo when he died.
Wow.
Trey Anastasio from Fish, Susan Tedeschi, Derek Trucks, all Widespread. It was just an ensemble of musicians playing.
Yeah.
But he had this philosophy. He's like, yeah, musical theory, it's great. Like, learn it.
Mm-hmm.
But just play the note. And if it sucks, make it suck.
Yeah.
Like with feeling.
With
and if you do that, and my guitar teacher told me a joke one time. He's like, play one note and it doesn't sound right. Play it again. Still doesn't sound right. Play it a third time. Now you're doing jazz.
Play it continuously.
Yeah. And but yeah, he's just like, you know, there's what does it mean to suck?
Yeah.
You know, and he would kind of talk about and it inspired all of these other people, this philosophy of how to write and play music and
yeah,
write original content.
Right.
And you hear all of these people talking about that influence, and then you hear him kind of providing commentary in past. And it's just really interesting, just like, hey, put yourself out there. Like, be vulnerable. It may be terrible.
Yeah.
And you may look back in 20 years and you've refined it and it's awesome, but it was bad then, you know?
I saw the Grateful Dead in San Francisco when I was out there, and it was me and about 9 million bikers, you know. I mean,
yeah,
it was quite an audience. But it's like they started playing, and I think they must have been a little on the high side at the time, because they'd come in with their lot of faulty notes to begin with, but then the faulty notes became part of the whole texture, and it was shamanic. It was like
mm-hmm.
they hypnotized everybody. It's like you moved into this flow of this really powerful stuff. It was the best live concert. I've seen a lot of concerts. It was the best live concert I've ever seen.
What year was this that you had seen
it? I think it must have been 1984.
Wow.
Something like that.
Okay, that would have been a great Brent Medlin would have been the keyboard player at that time. He was their last keyboard player, I believe, before Jerry passed away.
I think Jerry had a kind of notion that he was a sort of shaman too, that he could affect, make magic. He could, or make the muse sing right there in front of everybody and with everybody. And all he had to do is, and he's, you know, kind of chubby guy, right? Mm-hmm. And he never really looked very imposing. But when he got up and played, he could just, you know, you'd like get sucked into it. It'd become part of the whole environment. And the only thing I can compare it to is Allen Ginsberg, the poet. I worked at Hendrix. I graduated from Hendrix and then came back from California and worked there for a year or two. And we invited Allen Ginsberg to read. And his poem, Howl, is this long, shamanic, rhythmic piece. And he plays an Indian keyboard, you know, one of those portable mm-hmm. keyboards, and sometimes a bongo drum or something to go with it. You know, it's very beatnik, right? And it was just like a mantra, this poem. And the mantra literally just made everybody whoa into this space where we were open and listening, and maybe that's full of awe again, you know?
Yeah, okay. So you've had some incredible experiences.
Yeah, it was cool.
Yeah, and too, I just keep sitting here thinking, okay, so one thing we will talk about, and we can just sidebar into that was, so I graduated high school with your oldest son, Ben is the oldest, I believe. Then when I was a senior, Dan Stahl, he was the drama teacher there at Clarksville. He's now at Russellville, but I was his TA as a student assistant type person for one period. And that was the period that the junior high people in ninth grade, they would come up and they could take drama one first period. And so Hannah was in that class.
Yeah.
Right. And I think Dylan is younger than Hannah.
No, they're twins.
Oh, they're twins. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think, she's younger by about 15, 20 minutes or an hour, maybe.
Okay. you know, so interesting. I may have known that. I may not have. But
two different people you would never know. He's like a brick. You know, he's kind of a thick, not fat. He's good looking, but he's kind of thick. And she's kind of skinny and spry.
And an amazing actress.
An amazing actress, and he's an artist.
And he is an incredible
Whoa.
Artist. I have shown many people his Instagram.
Yeah.
Just really blows me away what he is able to do.
I think he has 3 million followers on TikTok. So, and, you know, he's made a living over the past 3 years. He did learn some drawing from Tammy Harrington here and Dawn. Was the art professor at the University of the Ozarks. But what he didn't really learn the way he does his art until he got off on his own and started experimenting. He literally developed his own way of doing photorealism. And then when people on TikTok and places like that said, these are photographs, you're just faking it. He started going on TikTok and on Twitch.
Mm-hmm.
And doing, the whole drawing in front of people so that they would know what he did.
Yeah.
And the stuff he does has put him in the international scene of photorealism. He's well known all over the world.
What is your website? WilliamAiken.com?
Yeah, so it's WILLIAM, middle initial R. So WILLIAMR. EAKIN.com.
Okay. I saw some of his artwork on your website.
Oh, great.
Just like browsing around, kind of just reading about your works. And I saw this one picture that he did of Hannah.
Yeah.
And I think she's like maybe like has her hand on her face or something. But it literally blows me away.
Yeah, I hope everybody will go see Dylan Eakin, DYLAN. EAKIN on TikTok or Twitch or any of those places, because it's really, it's mind blowing.
Yes. Has he done any podcasts or anything like that?
Well, he does a, I don't know if he's doing podcasts, but he does, he does regular TikTok things mm-hmm. where he's literally just there for an hour or two drawing.
Yeah.
And he talks it through. And I think he's moved some of that to Twitch. So if you go on Twitch looking for him.
There's a big audience on Twitch. I haven't streamed to Twitch, but this little pad I have over here, that's one of the, you can set it up to do, just be a push of a button.
Well, he's just astonishing, and he sells prints, and now his originals are really worth a lot. So he's making a living, significant living, just selling the originals. But then he sells prints as well.
Yeah.
But only signed prints for just a time, and they literally went from $10 or $15, to, well, I can't say how much, a lot.
Yeah.
So they're pricey and they're valuable, and people are collecting them all over the world.
That's amazing.
I'm really proud of him. And I'm proud of Hannah, too. She's
in New York, right?
Theater actress. They're both in New York.
Wow.
And she had a dream, which was to be in theater, and a lot of her friends did, too. And they slowly but surely either went off and did things that were related to mm-hmm. theater. A few of them kept going and did some magnificent theater work, a couple of them especially. And then Hannah's, made a living in professional theater since she graduated from OCU. And she was recently in the Pirates of Penzance in a Gilbert and Sullivan company out of New York that's been there since 1972.
They did a rendition of that at Tech when I was going, and Dr. Dykema was in it.
Yeah, there you go.
I want to say either that or I'm conflating that with we did it at Clarksville because I was in theater at Clarksville.
Yeah.
But I've seen that performance, but I've seen three or four Pirate performances.
One of my favorites, and Gilbert and Sullivan, this company is on the road this next year, and I can't really say anything more about it.
Yeah.
Technically can't say anything more about it, except that I'm pretty sure they're going to have one Fayetteville show.
Yeah, good.
So yeah. And she's also a filmmaker, so if anybody gets an opportunity, she's on what's the name of the, I can't remember the name of the site, but she does, she's got a film-based set of films. She's gone through the history of filmmaking.
Interesting.
And she and I have watched, and I bought a whole bunch of them, films from the 1910s to today, and watched how they made their films. And then she takes the poetry of a woman named Sarah Teasdale, and she's got 99 poems, very, very short, but she sets them to a film style, like film noir or 60s style or German expressionism, and does the set and the costume and the acting, and then sometimes takes on other people to do the acting and does these little films. And so, gosh, I can't remember the name of the website.
If Dylan and Hannah, either one, are listening, which I imagine they will listen to this, I would love to talk with each of them about their journeys. And Ben has come on at least twice.
Yeah.
He's done one in the studio, and he did one at my house.
Yeah.
So, and again, we graduated together, and he is an amazing musician.
Well, talk about somebody who lives his music. He's working on a musical, and he works at a nursing home,
yes,
a residence center, where he's the activities director, one of co-directors,
mm-hmm.
and they do music almost continuously,
yes,
as far as I can tell. And the one thing he's said over and over again is that sometimes you can have somebody who's really out of it, who doesn't remember their own children, who's sitting there, doesn't say or do anything. You play a song that they know, they start singing, they might dance, their whole mind opens back up. So memory and music, well, they're both related to the muses,
mm-hmm.
And music is something that opens a lot of us. We all go back and remember. And even when we forget, you know, even if it's remembering the Oscar Mayer Wiener song or something, you know, it's still up here.
Yeah.
Some of it we can't get rid of. And, you know, the truth is a lot of stuff we don't want to because it's the most important part of us.
Like your story.
Yeah.
In German. That
yeah.
You're talking about.
Yeah, thank you. That's right. Yeah, yeah. That's right.
But yeah, that's, Ben is, he talked about that on the podcast and, you know, he had worked, for a time also, my Aunt Joy Wilson is the CEO of Foister Davis and,
for whom I worked when I first came to town.
Oh,
and,
okay.
And she said, you know, we're going to develop a office of volunteerism out there. Would you come do it? So I did. And I did a couple of things and I take personal responsibility for having turned, I didn't do a whole heck of a lot, but did turn a report in that argued that Johnson County should be a volunteer community. And we're a volunteer community now, according to the sign, 10 years after we did the first time, and we got it. So we had a little sign, volunteer community, in part because of Joy. And telling me to go do this or, you know, giving me some things to do as a volunteer.
Yeah. Well, she is so great.
And
the things that she's done over time, I just remember it from when I was a kid to what they're doing now is truly amazing.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then he had talked, I talked with him just about how he'd worked with music with different groups.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
This is also like right around, I think we talked before and then after the pandemic, Ben and I.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
He was recording some amazing music. It was just like literally one of the songs he made I was listening to all the time.
Yeah.
And I talked with him about his music a little bit, but he's always been had an amazing vocal talent and an amazing just ability to pick up an instrument.
Yeah, and he's playing with a group now, too.
Oh, nice.
I don't know the name of the group. So, yeah, he's just started. He's playing the bass.
Oh, wow, nice.
Picked it up and learned it.
I could see that.
Some of my best bass players walked in and we showed them what a bass was and they took off. You know, so I've seen it happen. And he's really, so Ben is the only person I know who could listen to Bach's Toccata and Fugue in D minor, sit down at a piano and play it by ear.
Wow.
He can do that. And he does that. Not as much now, but I mean, he can read the music, but he can literally hear something and pick it out.
Mm-hmm.
And that's incredible. If you think about Toccata and Fugue in D minor, you know, you just sit down and play it.
Wow.
That's,
wow.
I don't know how, it's almost like, well, that's a muse or an angel maybe. You know, it's just something just overcomes you and you do it.
Yes.
And he's always been able to do that kind of stuff. I'm proud of him very much.
Well, and, you know, just sitting here talking with, I wonder, I could definitely see some influence. I mean, I don't know if there are links there, but, you know, if you were my dad, I would probably be into some of that. I talk to Cor all the time.
Well, obviously, somebody was, and obviously, you're here doing your
exactly.
stuff.
Exactly. But, that, you know, my wife and I have been trying to get pregnant for almost 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we are to this place in that where she's had a couple of procedures done, really highly likely that it might happen this week.
Keep
and
our
it
fingers
might,
crossed.
And it might be twins. I was thinking that earlier.
Keep two fingers crossed.
But, which it'll be fine. It'll be fine. I'll just be happy when it happens.
I am not going to complain about having my twins. Okay. Although, if people say it's the same amount of work, you can tell them to go shut it.
I can imagine.
It's a little more work, but man, it's great.
But, you know, just here's a question for you. So, like, she and I talk about this, like, obviously, I would like my kids to do the stuff that your kids do, theater and band and choir and just the arts and humanities. But that's kind of an interesting concept about wanting something for someone else, you know. And two, it's like, yeah, I could see like, oh, man, Bill's into lots of awesome stuff that I like. oh, it makes sense why Ben's into, you know, he was a singer in a band when I was in high school.
And yeah.
Yeah, I could see some parallels, but also I could see where you don't want to force anything on anyone. And how did it turn out that way? Did you have a parenting style that, you know?
No, I although some of my favorite people think that I was too lax for a lot of things. So, you know, I think you have to take it easy. And it's that you try to grab and possess it, then you've just destroyed it.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't grab and possess anybody, especially a kid.
Yeah.
You know, the child. And you can't grab and possess what they're going to be or what you imagine that they would be, because it almost inevitably means they'll do the opposite.
Yes.
You know, so I think you just have to strive and thrive on. All things must pass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, really. And be okay if they don't want to be an actor, or if they don't want to be a, you know, or you know, if they, none of them wanted to be artists, then they all wanted to be in the Marines. I've got a niece who's a Marine, you know. I guess I would not have encouraged my kids to be thinking that, but if they said, we'd like to be Marines too, then that would be part of who we all were. Yeah. And so I think we're afraid, we adults are afraid to change.
For sure.
And so the more afraid we are of that, the harder we think we can hold on to something. But you can't hold on to anything. And if the harder you try, the harder you squeeze, the more likely you just kill that thing. You know?
Yeah.
So letting it be. So let it be is the, you know, the Beatles thing. But it's also, Martin Heidegger says it, Nietzsche says it, the Buddhists say it. Let it be. Just chill.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me, stand in awe and sin not. That sounds pretty good. Whatever sin means, it can mean, you know, stifling other people.
Yeah.
But it can also mean, you got to teach etiquette here and there, and you got to be, you know, model that kind of stuff, I guess. And I'm not a good model. I was in a rock band in San Francisco. Come on.
You've seen The Grateful Dead in 1984.
Yeah, once you've seen The Grateful Dead, you know you're gone. But you know, that too was more of a to go, not just go with the flow, whatever happens, but go with the flow being there fully and completely. And yeah. Man, if you can do that, then that's all the Buddhists have to say. That's all you need.
Do you think that, I mean, obviously you've had a lifetime to develop these ideas you have today, right now. But was there a period of your life where, I mean, how long have you been sort of at this place?
Third grade.
Even better. But that's, I mean, and that's, you know, because that's interesting.
I was probably a little less confident about speaking such things. But, you know, I remember, I think in eighth or ninth grade, I was over at what was the equivalent of Hastings and picked up a book called The Upanishads, and I read most of it sitting there. And I said, this is stuff I've been thinking all along. So I think people have ears tuned for certain kinds of things already, and mm-hmm. we're born that way. And I don't think that means we don't change, and I'm very happy to change, but maybe recognizing that change is continuous is, how do you change out of that? Well, I don't want to change out of that. Yeah. So there's a kind of process of just going with the flow, both in terms of what you believe and think and in terms of what you hear, and just learning to listen to other people. And that listening process, I guess, was helped by, I met some, when I came back and worked at Hendrix for a while, I worked with a theologian there, Christian theologian, who nevertheless had gone to Japan and learned Buddhism. He had gone there to teach a Buddhist Zen Roshi English, and in the process, he himself got certified as having a Satori experience, you know, living there with the Zen master. And he essentially sees himself as a Buddhized Christian. And I met a whole community of people
That's interesting.
And that community included a group of people that I helped pull together in Berkeley, California, for people who were counted themselves as Christian liberation theologians, Christian on the social transformation side of things, and who nevertheless did that in dialogue with Buddhism. And so there's a whole group of people like that. And to me, what that did was emphasize the compassion part that's very, very important to Buddhism. Buddhism, you wake up, and so your knowledge is increased, but what that means is your compassion is increased simultaneously. It's two sides to the same coin. And I guess these Christian theologians that I was working with were learning how deeply important that was to engage with other people in love. And they called it love. So I think that's really, really important. I don't know how I got onto talking about that group, except that it's both all the stuff we've been talking about simultaneous with, you know, care for the other. And I guess if we're interconnected, if we're not like concrete blocks that are separate, that means in this moment we're connected. We're breathing the same air, sucking in the same viruses, whatever we happen to be doing, but we're also hearing each other's voices, and we're impacted by that. And if that's true, everything around me makes up who I am. And if that's true, the people that are suffering, the dogs that are down at the you know, the dog mill down here, and somebody's abusing them, their suffering impacts me. Mm-hmm. Whether or not you're a vegetarian or not, suffering of animals diminishes us. What diminishes the lives of others diminishes us. And so that's the root of compassion. So both awakeness and compassion are important, both in terms of being with people on the street or being people, you know, in the political realm, but also raising a kid. Mm-hmm. If you don't start with that, then, well, it's a good place to start here. And here you just realize, wow, I wouldn't be anything like I am now without my kids there. And it's not just the kids, it's everybody.
Yeah. So when did you start writing in this whole journey?
So in third grade, I told you, that's where that's how we got off on all that other stuff. In third grade, my teacher had a little SRA kind of book. SRA was a reading program for kids. And this book was had writing prompts. And so there was a writing prompt in a notebook that said, imagine the squirrel, he jumps into a truck from a tree, and then write a story. And so I wrote a little story, and I thought that was pretty cool. And then from that moment on, I was doing some kind of writing. In eighth grade, I started reading science fiction with these philosophical implications, like Uncle Ira, you know, what's wrong with Uncle Ira, all that stuff. And I read, they had what they called pulp magazines. Mm-hmm. Pulp magazines were digest magazines that had really great science fiction, Arthur C. Clarke and people like that writing in them, but had huge circulation. So they were cheap, and they were newspaper print, but you know, some of them had 200,000 or 300,000 people reading circulation. And I wanted to be an analog, so I wrote a story and I sent it to Analog in eighth grade, and they said, we want to encourage you because this is really, you know, a very interesting thing, but you're obviously young. And so, in other words, you're rejected. But ever since that rejection, I said, I'm going to be someday, I'm going to be in a pulp magazine and it's going to be on a 10-cent table, and somebody's going to pay 10 cents to get this used copy of my story. And what that really means is I want to produce these artifacts that stay, you know? And so, and sure enough, analog is one of the big science fiction, hardcore, you got to know your science kind of thing. So I am not that. But I tried it there, and then 5 or 6 years ago, I had a story published in analog. So I finally made it. It took me 40 years to get there, but I did. And so then I started writing regularly, and in the 1990s, I started writing sort of satirical stories with a lot of heart and muse, I hope, called in a little place I invented called Redgunk, Mississippi. And Redgunk, Mississippi, so I had been, I was a single dad. I lived in a mobile home waiting to build my house on my property, surrounded by weeds mostly. And I started writing about not characters that I had met, but characters who lived out in the country, who nevertheless were full of, just had little magical, weird science fiction things happen to them. And science fiction, fantasy, and sometimes horror, and sometimes just literary things. And I was, I have the equivalent of a master's in literature, 2 master's degrees in philosophy, and a PhD in philosophy. So too many degrees. But the literature was helpful because I read James Joyce and some of the really big guns. And I was just enthralled by how writing can make writing itself, the sound of the language, and writing outside the box, not just storytelling, but singing like poetry, can really open people's minds and can open my mind. So I started writing these Redgunk tales, which are making fun of country folk, which I was by then, and at the same time not making fun of them, but really cherishing them and letting them be in weird settings. Like one guy named Boy Howdy gets taken off by a UFO, gets yanked out of the, you know, off the earth, and they realize he's homesick, and the aliens get sick of him because he's so homesick, so they throw him back onto Earth, but in the process they duplicate him. So it's another duplicating story. So Boy Howdy meets Boy Howdy's self simultaneously, and they're in the same mobile home out in the same weeds, but they now have to deal with each other. And what they do, I hope somebody will come read that story, because it's really...
Spoiler alert.
It's no spoilers. Yeah. The question is, how do I live with myself? Right.
Yeah, okay.
And one of my first stories that got big published, so it got, all these got published in pulp magazines or some of the other science fiction magazines in late 1990s. There was a magazine called Realms of Fantasy, which included all the great fantasy writers, all of them. I ended up in 7 issues before that magazine kind of folded. They folded in part because it was a print magazine and they had these beautiful paintings. So I loved the paintings. I loved seeing the stories there. 20,000, 30,000 people easily read each story. And they won a bunch of awards. So I really hit the publishing pretty hard and pretty well for at least the time Realms of Fantasy was around. And then I got a call from a guy up in Connecticut, I think. Yeah, Vermont. From a publisher called Invisible Cities Press. And they put out a first collection of these stories that had been published. There were only about a fifth of them.
How many stories are in that one there?
I don't know. But this is a fifth of this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10, 11, 12.
Okay.
So there's, and all of these were published, well-published for science fiction fantasy. And they're all published in fantasy and science fiction magazines, which was peculiar to me, because usually the genres are very rule governed. You if you're science fiction, you write science fiction and what it means. But this was all weirdly literary too. So I was always making fun of people like James Joyce or William Faulkner. I love both of those guys. But I write what a critic said was maximalism, which means I just write everything. And so it's a stream of consciousness kind of thing too. Actually, so the editor of Realms of Fantasy says it's sort of like Thomas Wolfe on acid or James Joyce on moonshine.
That's a great comparison.
Yeah. And, you know, it really reads like that, but when you get through it, you go, whoa, how did I get here? One guy wrote, a reviewer wrote, it didn't just change my mind, it changed my soul. And I don't do that. But something did. And so I felt like, well, maybe the muse does talk.
Yeah. So you're publishing these, you said, throughout the late 90s. When did this first come out?
This came out in 2001, okay. this one. And then I got another call from an LGBTQ press called Laith Press. And he pretty much said, well, I know you're a straight guy and you're writing stuff that I don't usually publish, but we really want to publish your Redgunk stories. So I said, well, you know, if you publish that, I want it in hardback. And I want a really, really nice book, And I want it to include everything I ever wrote in Redgunk for 30 years. And he said, okay. And he had it illustrated on the cover, which I think is beautiful.
Yeah.
And then I said, you know what, I want another thing. And I said, well, what I want is my son Dylan to draw a couple things, just a couple things. So he drew a map, kind of like J.R. Tolkien,
yeah.
Right? And then at the very end, he included a portrait of me. Someplace back here in the notes about the author. Let's see. I don't even know where it is. I don't see it. Someplace back there.
I think that's probably the same one I saw on your website.
Yeah, it's on the website. So they produced this beautiful book, and it's $39 on the website, but sale $33, you know. Currently,
is it just
on Laith
the press
publishing?
Their press is also on your website as well.
Yeah. So WILLIAMREAKIN, .com.
All right.
Yeah, and so there's connection to that, and there's a free story that's sitting there. Lawnmower Moe is the first story ever published by Realms of Fantasy, and it's in both of these books. And I also put it on for free on the website. And I'm about to put up, Hannah did an oral.
Yes,
you were
mentioning that, which I love audiobooks. That's my
really
favorite mode.
I'm excited about that. And now I'm going to go back to Laith Press and say, I know you did this book exactly like I want, but now we need an oral version. So I'm hoping they'll do at least some of the stories, maybe hire Hannah to do the narration.
Oh, she would do great.
Yeah.
So
far,
for sure.
This one that she's just done, she's choosing her favorites, and also a lot of them are narrated by men. So she really, it's kind of probably not be able to do that, but some of them she'll do, I think.
Yeah, that'll
I hope.
Be, that'll be exciting and awesome for her to be involved, too.
Yeah.
So outside of Redgunk, though, uh-huh. You have... I saw some other works. You had, I think, half a dozen or so on your website.
So I did some early work in nonfiction. So I've done literary essays on William Blake and Percy Bysshe Shelley. I did some collecting of different kinds of theology with a friend of mine from Hendrix. So we did... collection of women writing about their religious traditions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity, Islam, but from a feminist perspective. And then I did a collection of, from the World Council of Churches, of Christian theologians talking about how theology can impact ecology. And so I helped edit those books.
That's interesting.
And then I've done a whole mess of poetry and a whole bigger mess, literally a mess maybe, of science fiction, fantasy, and literary works, that short stories that appeared in different magazines. But they're, it's kind of hard to collect something that's not, that aren't really connected.
Mm-hmm.
So the collection Redgunk is really what I've spent most of my time on. But I'm also writing three or four things. I'm working with a friend of mine I mentioned to you off the air earlier, who used to work for the Arkansas Democrat Gazette. If you drive toward Russellville, you look up and see a billboard that has Otto the Otter advertising the state parks, mm-hmm. and not to litter. And Otto the Otter is his creation.
Okay.
And so he's all over the place. And I just recently moved him to Tucson. So he's one of the fellows I mentioned to you living in Arizona. But he used to work for Twilight Zone magazine.
Wow.
And or it did some work that way. He helped develop some of the Hellraiser characters. And
wow.
So he also is an award-winning fiction writer, and been in some of the magazines, fantasy and science fiction, for example, that I've been in. And he was the first to, he wrote a full-page review of Redgunk Tales when the first one book came out in 2001. And so that's how I got to know him. And he and I are writing a set of books that are unpublished, that are reminiscent of Raymond Chandler and the film noir kind of, you know, Philip Marlowe mm-hmm. detective series. We're doing that, setting it in a fantasy world. And so he and I are working on that. And then I just printed out a 380-page manuscript that I'm working on that's sort of semi-autobiographical. Because I've done some pretty cool things, and I've lived some pretty cool places, so I'm drawing from those, and I've known some
yes.
really interesting people. And so kind of pulling all that together into a kind of an autobiographical novel. That's, and I figure this will probably never be published. I don't really care. Emily Dickinson wrote a lot of her poetry and put it in a drawer and literally left it. I mean, planned on leaving it, planned on destroying it, except they found it. And so they've published it. And, you know, now, well, we have Emily Dickinson.
Yeah, for sure.
But I imagine that there, so I realized that I was writing with the glee of getting published for a long time. And with this novel, I said, you know what, I think I'm going to write it as if I will not ever try to publish it, and that I'll destroy it at the end. Because that, by the way, is the real novel I need to write. So I'm working on that.
All right. That's a interesting approach. But yeah. I would say lines up with a lot of the things we've talked about today.
Yeah.
Well, hey, man, I think we can go ahead and wrap this up for today. But
great.
It has been awesome talking
hey,
to you.
Hey, likewise.
And, just, you know, awesome small world that we kind of know a lot of the same people. You know, my Aunt Joy. And,
it's amazing stuff.
But, yeah, but you've had what I would sum up as an amazing life, it sounds like.
Yeah.
So I was really looking forward to talking with you today, especially, again, I didn't know that you were a philosophy professor until somewhat recently, within the last few months.
Yeah.
And I even saw you talking with Ardith Morris.
Oh, yeah. Good friend of mine.
Yes, and my wife and I, too.
We've gone on a couple of trips together.
Okay.
We went to Italy together.
One, Wellen, who we call Shanky.
Love him.
But he he stopped by the studio a while back, and he'd shown me his hand. But I was thinking.
How is his hand?
It's pretty good. I gave him this thing I had that I use sometimes for carpal tunnel.
Yeah.
That was like something you could squeeze your fingers on.
Yeah.
But he was, you know,
he was
scarred
injured,
up. Yes.
Injured pretty badly.
Mm-hmm.
Set building.
Yes. Yeah. But he was one of that group of ninth graders that I was TA in that class, and he went on to do theater. But I just caught up with him recently. Ardith gave me a couple old record players' turntables, and I kind of fixed them up.
Ardith is probably the most generous person I know.
She is a treasure. I really admire her, and is just an awesome person.
Yeah. I need to see her because we've been talking about going to Greece. Ooh. But she's been talking. We've been talking about that for a long time, and I've sort of been backing out along the way. But I need to back in.
Yeah.
One of my Redgunk stories is about this fat guy named Otis Onus Zabrowski, who's a cable TV guy, who's a little on the slow side going to Greece and what he experiences there. It's pretty mind-blowing.
It's just like Candide. Like, stories of world travel are interesting, and you can tell people a lot about places and ideas through... I mean, that's one thing that stands out about Candide. And one last thing, I was thinking back on Voltaire, you know, and poetry, you were saying a second ago.
Yeah.
I just read this story. You know, he went to Frederick the Great's court. But Frederick the Great, before he was even king, was admiring Voltaire.
Yeah.
And so he goes to tutor Frederick in poetry and philosophy. And they have a falling out. And Voltaire takes Frederick's poems, and they're bad. They're bad poems, and he's going to take them and publish them to embarrass him. And he gets stopped at the border, and I think has to spend a few days or a few weeks, in a jail. But he got stopped leaving Prussia. Just a funny story. Anyway, but I have had a really great time talking to you, and I appreciate you coming out, and thanks to Ben, because I think this was maybe his idea.
He suggested it, yeah. Well, and I'm glad he did.
Me too. Well, thank you, Bill.
We'll
talk to you soon.
What a pleasure.